And post. live.
Nah, that's a lot of. We're live, pal.
We're back. Dude, we're back. Wrestling Ruckus.
Hello.
He ain't dead.
Hello.
Just like AJ Styles pushing the glove hand through the dirt at WrestleMania. He's resurrected. And then we're going to carry on just like AJ Styles, like nothing happens. Like, you just didn't get buried the fucking couple of weeks later.
That's what. That's it. This got to be the Ruckus boys. This got to be them.
I'm Eddie Reese.
We're back. I'm Ryan Williams. We're back, lads. We're back.
Yeah, guys, we're just going to chat. We ain't really going to get to... we ain't going to break down segments and shit. We're just going to talk about the wrestling business, what's been happening now, what was happening in the period, maybe, if we get into that while we're away.
Yeah.
While we were away. A lot of it. But let's start. Yeah. We ain't going to drag this out. Let's start showing our respects to Shad Gaspard. Dude, the reason why, usually I kind of breeze over a lot of deaths in the public eye, but I think it's worthy giving him a shout out.
Definitely.
Because he went out like a hero. You know, he sacrificed himself for his son, saved my boy. He drowned for anyone who's been living under a rock, like, with a fire. Where you been if you ain't hurt? Yeah, outside with his boy. Got hit with a strong tide, I think it was riptide, whatever they called it. Current underneath, it's crashed over them and turns the water like a washing machine. You just get stuck in it and you get dragged under. Lifeguard got out, went out there. The only one lifeguard though. That's why it was so messy to try and save him. And he said, no, leave me, take my boy. And yeah, by the back, he was gone. That was like Saturday. And I didn't find him until...
Saturday or Sunday. Did they find him yesterday? Yes, Tuesday.
Tuesday, yeah.
Yeah.
Crazy, man, but... Respect to the guy. Always seemed like a nice dude. Whenever I see interviews, always seemed cool. He was doing movies. You know, he was in, he was like a stuntman in Black Panther.
Dude, I didn't even realize I saw it.
And do you know, really? He's the body, the motion capture for Kratos in the God of War game. The most recent one.
Really?
He was fucking Kratos. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Motherfucker, he's like 6'7". He was doing bare shit, man. He was like living his best life.
He was such a good dude, man. Always had a smile on his face.
Mm.
You know, like, obviously I was around watching wrestling. I know you weren't really watching wrestling at the time. Crime Time was about. I like those guys. I was a bit annoyed. Like, you didn't really do much with them. And of course, you know, the gimmick was a little bit limited. But.
Yeah, a little bit stereotypical.
Yeah, it was.
I didn't take to it that much. But what was this? Oh, I heard stuff saying that. Part of the reason why it didn't work out, could be wrong because I wasn't watching it this time, but it was partly down to Cena. They were one of the victims to Cena's golden shovel. Is that true?
Well, I'm not. You know what? I don't really know too much about it. I'm not going to sit here and act like I do.
Mm.
But I do remember a little time period that I'm not sure if it was before they broke up or they broke up then they got back together. But I remember they were rolling with Cena and they trashed up JBL's limo. I remember that little promo. That. But, I mean, if it was, then it was. But again, I hold my hands up. I'm not going to sit here and act like I remember because that was a good 8-9 years ago now.
Oh, you can't at the time.
Yeah, because I was holding something, my bad. But, you know what I'm saying? Like, that was a long time ago. So I'm not going to sit here and act like
I remember. Yeah, sad thing, sad thing.
Respect to Duke, though, man. Went out with a hero, bro. Saving the son.
Wishes and condolences to the family. Crazy, man. But his son lived. He's going to carry on.
Yeah.
That's important there. That's what he wanted.
It's beautiful, man. It's beautiful, man. It's beautiful. So, it's obviously, it's unfortunate thing, but beautiful, man.
Back to pro wrestling, man. What's been happening since we've been... how long has it been? Fuck.
Has it been a year?
It can't be a year yet.
Nah, I think it's been a year, dude.
Nah, I can't be that long.
I think it's been almost a year.
That's fucked up.
Been almost a year. I've had two channels now. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, it's been a year.
If you're watching this rather than hearing the audio, which is in our feed, Wrestling Ruckus, check that out on all podcasting platforms. But if you're watching this, you're not going to be watching this on the Wrestling Ruckus YouTube channel. You're actually going to be watching this on the Voltron Network channel. So this might be your first exposure to Wrestling Ruckus. where I don't know how whether this is us permanently back, maybe jumping in every week.
We'll talk about that. We'll
see what's going on, how it feels. Yeah. But yeah, the reason why, from my side of things, I fell out of love with a lot of what was going on in wrestling. I think I was at burnout point. WWE at that point was so bad. I just couldn't take it no more. I needed to stop. I needed to step away. And I still kept up with what was going on. Still read the news, still saw what was going on social media, but as far as sitting down and watching a 3-hour Raw, I just couldn't stomach doing that shit anymore, man. It was, you know, I didn't want to lie to you guys. I didn't want to read results on a webpage or something and then come up on here on the podcast acting like I'd watched the whole thing, giving my opinions on it. That wouldn't be right. That wouldn't be real. We have to be honest to you guys.
We love the people, and we get the people exactly the more authentic stuff. And for me, it was pretty much the same thing. I mean, I burnt out from it. I had a lot of other personal issues I needed to sort out. Of course, I have a YouTube channel. Of course, I will tell you guys about it at the end of the show. No cheap plugs right now. But, you know what I mean? A lot of stuff, changing jobs and et cetera. Yeah, but maybe back to wrestling.
Both left the job that we're at, man.
Yeah. We got out.
House, moves, you know? Living, all sorts of shit, man. It's crazy. What's that? Damn, that's been a year.
We grew up.
Fuck off.
Oh, shit. But we grew up. Yeah. But, yeah, we're back. We're here.
Actually, no, it has not been a year yet because AEW is not quite at the 1-year mark. And we were talking about the year.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Technically, it could have.
It started at, like, November time at the end of last year. So it's actually still early. So it's not quite there yet.
Are you sure?
Yeah, definitely, man. Definitely. Double or Nothing's coming up, and that was like their second event, maybe.
I'm pretty sure it was their first.
It was All Out as their first
property. All Out, then Double or Nothing. Double or Nothing was like their first since they got the TV deal type of thing, right? Yeah.
Almost a year. Yeah, because that was when Moxley...
Pretty much a year, man.
Yeah, because Moxley's baby stayed there. Fucking flung Kenny off with a stack of chips. Yo, almost. So how have you felt? So almost a year of AEW. How have you felt AEW's gone this first year?
I think they've been okay. I mean...
Has it lived up to what you wanted?
Have they... Yeah, I could say so. I mean, I wasn't expecting them to completely slap WWE because, let's face it, WWE are a big juggernaut. But let's be honest, guys, the product itself was dying down anyways.
Yeah.
AEW was that breath of fresh air that we all needed. And, well, I've spoken to a lot of older heads, and they've said, listen, they even got back interested because of AEW. So, for me personally, I've enjoyed it. Is it lived up to their expectations? Yeah, I say so, and there's plenty more. But, of course, because of this current situation that we're all suffering right now, I think it's definitely taken a little hinder in it. What about you?
Yeah, that's sure. Corona's fucked everything up. But AEW overall, I think I'd say I'm going to be real critical. I wanted it to succeed because I was a big Omega fan. I was a big Young Bucks fan. Not a Cody fan, to be honest. But
yeah, we know.
Cody started off. He had a lot of decent matches in the first couple of events. And he was winning me over. But I'm starting to turn on Cody again now. Because I'm starting to feel like he's turned into Triple H. He is Triple H now. He is.
The first debate, guys, on this.
Blatantly is. He just built himself way too strong. He's burying everybody. I guess the test is Double or Nothing. If he beats...
Lance Archer.
Huh?
Lance Archer.
Yeah, if he beats Archer, then that's it. He is officially the shitty king of kings without the muscles. He is. Archer should not be losing. They need monsters. Everyone's so small in that company. They need monsters that are credible. And if they beat him...
They do.
He's fucked. But I think
he's gone.
But I think because he's written himself out, because they knew that people would bitch about him being the AEW champion. I think he's going to view the TNT championship belt, because this is what it's building up to. I think he's going to view that as his belt that he's going to have, and he's going to have for like a year or two. Like, he's going to go from the crazy RVD TV. You know, remember the RVD TV championship belt? We had that shit for years. He's going to be like,
yeah, that. I don't know. I mean, I see your point in terms of the whole Triple H thing, even though I'm a bit like, dude, come on. But I get what you're saying, because it's funny you say that, because I think back at that little stunt that he did when he had the sledgehammer and then there was the chair and he started smashing it up. Do you know what I mean? I wasn't wanting to stop. It's just, you know. But I see what you're saying, but at the same time, look at the matches he had with Darby Allin. I mean, come on, man. I mean, I never heard of Darby Allin even before that, but
don't get wrong.
After he had a match with him, I thought, yo,
he's had good. Better matches than I expected he was capable of having.
But yeah, you've been cracking on it for like a year, dog.
At the beginning of this, he was saying that AEW was about getting over new, young talent, the next generation. Obviously, you have to build it on the fame and the credibility that the Elite Core have. But look at how the Young Bucks have booked themselves, because they're each booking their own storylines. Young Bucks are kind of in charge of the tag team stuff. Cody's in charge of most of the single stuff and blood, et cetera, et cetera. But the Young Bucks, they've been a lot more balanced. They haven't run Russia over all the other tag teams. They've had good matches and they've won a good few, but they've lost a bunch as well. Lucha Brothers, they've lost a bunch to them. They lost to Private Party.
Love Private Party.
They've been putting them over, building new stars like they said that they were going to do. Whereas Cody, I think Darby, beat him for the first match.
He has put him over. He has. Come on.
Let's be honest. How many has Darby won?
What, over Cody?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. You know what? I don't remember. I think he's beaten him. I'm sure he drew as well.
Yeah, there's a draw. But whenever Cody loses, he never loses clean. It's always some shit going on. There's always some.
No.
Never just lays down.
But, let's be honest. Let's put some respect on Cody, because the way that whole MJF thing was booked was actually good, because in the way MJF actually beat him in the end, when we all thought, okay, Cody's going to get it, because Cody's been taking a beating. He did a moonsault off the wood, but I still can't say his name, off the cage. He took the lashes on TV, which I'm not going to lie, I would have kicked your ass.
Ward lost. Ward's one of them stars. He's gained nothing from losing. He should have won.
Yeah, but still, I mean, no, but if he'd done that, we would have never got the MJF match. We never saw MJF get over the Cody, which was good, because let's think about it. So,
you're saying MJF gets Wardlow gets disqualified?
Say that again?
You're saying that Wardlow gets disqualified instead of getting pinned? Something, way to protect his aura of being this big, dangerous.
It was a cage match, man.
I don't know. There's always a way to get out of that shit.
I see what you're saying, but if they didn't put themselves in the cage match, then maybe. But you all know cage match, you can climb out
What was the logic of having a cage match with Wardlow? Wouldn't it make more sense to have a cage match with MJF? Because cage matches should be the final thing of a feud. That this feud has gotten so toxic that you have to cage these guys into a small space to settle it. It didn't really make sense it being with Wardlow, because he never really had any major. It was just for the
hear you, but you've got to remember the part that MJF is playing. Remember, MJF was playing the chicken shit heel, right? And Wardlow's the muscle. So I remember the crap that Cody took up towards that, right?
But it's trapped. That's the whole point of a cage, is that you can't...
No, of course. But why would Cody... why would MJF... Remember, MJF said, I'll only have a match with you, Cody, unless you go through all these hoops that I'm making you go through, right? So why would MJF put himself in a situation where it's like the worst possible thing for him in a cage with Cody Rhodes? You pissed him off. You betrayed him, etc. All that I ain't got anxiety that Cody Rhodes wants. And you know you can't touch him because you can't get this match, right? And all the fans, this is how you're going to bring in all the fans and all the drama, you know, being behind Cody. So how are you... It's not going to make sense. I hear where you're coming from, but it's not going to make sense.
You worried that there's some elements of WWE booking that are creeping into AEW. Kind of like with what you just said, that MJF is putting all these obstacles in front of Cody. Why is he doing that? How is he booking shit? He shouldn't be. I don't like this idea of this wrestlers booking their own shit.
Yeah, but if, new story but if that's the case, but if that's the case, then Cody would be more of a Triple H and then still book that match, the MJF, without all the story. You know what I'm saying?
Peel back what's actually the real bookers. I mean, like, do you think there should have been a figure or some sort of board, some sort of explanation as to why these matches happen the way they do, rather than it look like wrestlers just do it themselves, like they turn up and feel like, yeah, I'm going to have a match with this guy. So I decided to.
What do you mean?
You know, like, New Japan has a logic-based system of how people get their matches. They earn it by, you know, logical booking. Through, because it's like a sport. They present it like a sport, like UFC.
Right.
Wrestling, or like, people just turn up and decide they're going to fight someone. Next week, I'm going to face you. It's like, what are you deciding? You're not sport. You're an athlete. You should be, someone should be telling you what, you know, you deserve or who gets the next shot at a title. And it, remember when they started AEW, it was going to be a sports-based promotion that in the way that they presented it.
Even the cruiserweight division, even that cruiserweight tournament thing, which we'll get into in a bit, is kind of doing that.
Oh, the TNT.
Kind of in a sense with the points. Yeah, with NXT, they're kind of doing that. Even
though it's NXT.
Wah, 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 you know? So, but I don't know. I agree with you.
I fucked off NXT, bro. It's crazy. I was loving NXT at one point. Like, I was at a point where I was really battling with my loyalties because I was. My heart was behind what AEW was doing because I wanted these underdogs to succeed in doing their thing. But there's a part of me that still loved these NXT guys because I'd followed them so much of them on the indies that I wanted to see. And they were doing so well and the matches were awesome. I was loving it. But the last couple of months, probably this whole year, really, since January, it's kind of...
Even just, a little bit of last year. I mean...
It just feels miserable.
For me, anyway. I don't know. I mean, for me, I think it's down to even last year. I kind of was falling off NXT last year, even before like the UK thing happened as well. Like, I lost it because for me, when the stars started to go into the main roster, like guys like Sami Zayn, Shinsuke Nakamura, Kevin Owens, etc. I mean, you look at the path of Seth Rollins, right? He's probably the best person from NXT to do everything, right?
He's Roman,
you know what I mean? He's won every title. So, yeah,
him and Roman are the only
ones. Everybody else.
And Charlotte, I guess. For also.
Charlotte and the four. Everyone else has kind of been, meh.
Yeah, most recently, it's just, you can't really hope. You can't get excited about people moving up because they just get fucked.
But look at Bobby Roode.
TV. It was good to start with, but yeah, I know something weird, something missing about it now. I don't know what it is. Something's changed.
I don't know, but like I said, I feel like they've made too many drastic changes, and I feel like the fans themselves are smart. Well, we've always been smart, but I feel like we're smart enough to know, okay, well, your push ain't really going to be lasted long. And you notice, they ain't getting the same feel that they were from NXT to WWE. For example, do you remember when Kevin Owens answered John Cena's United States Championship Open Challenge? Remember that? And do you remember the pop that Kevin Owens got? Yeah. Who was at the time NXT champion. So we knew the call-up was coming.
You're going back.
But the pop.
For me.
Even Sami Zayn.
Yeah, but you're going back a couple of years. But for me,
NXT. I'm showing you something here. Look at that, right? But then, once Kevin Owens got to the main roster, the pop wasn't as loud as it was, and it would be. Then it only started rising up a little bit more when Jericho and friend. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because he wasn't the guy anymore. He wasn't the prize fighter.
No.
Scrap.
But this is the problem. Because he lost all that stuff. That's NXT origins. Yeah, that's you know what I'm saying?
Main roster don't... It's like it's almost as if the people that book main roster, including Vince, it's like they don't watch what happens on NXT. They don't care. They just...
No, they don't.
It's like blatantly with Shayna. They, even though I've not really been a Shayna fan, I could still see the value in what she was when she was in NXT. There was a value
this
there.
This was my point. And that's why I kept saying to you.
Female lesbian character. And it's like they just ignored that coming up. And yeah, she was like the... She got to rush over everyone in Chamber and all of that. But still, they don't seem to have a grasp on the character she is. And she's just flopped, in my opinion, on the main roster. Doesn't even really...
My thing was... The
main roster. It's all TV now, so...
But my thing was, I even told you before the whole Ronda Rousey thing, I said Shayna needed to go on SmackDown because at that time, SmackDown needed a credible and dominant heel to run roughshod through that. They missed the ball. They dropped it. And look now, like, Ronda's already come and gone and now they do it. And then we'll talk about the whole Becky Lynch situation in a minute. But, I mean, still, like, they dropped the ball. And, you know, my brother said this to me earlier, like, would it be, and this is a question to you as well, would it be wise if Shayna Baszler had, like, someone to talk for her? Maybe Shayna Baszler should be, like, a Paul Heyman girl. Is it too late? I don't know.
Well, it's not really right to say that, because there's always, you can always rehabilitate most people.
Yeah,
she probably should have had someone. That would have been
Heyman. That would have been handy.
Good call for that.
Maybe one of the MMA girls. But then again, are they really good on the mic? Nah. I haven't even seen them. Nah. I haven't even seen them. What happened to those girls? You know, Roddy's girl and the other girl. Like, those girls disappeared. They've disappeared. Yeah. I haven't seen them in a while.
They just ain't school fire, man. They're just not really... They ain't got it.
Oh, dude, let me quickly bring this up to your attention. I was watching... this is how bad I've fallen off NXT. I watched the highlights earlier, right? I ain't gonna lie to you guys. I watched the highlights of NXT earlier, right? And, dude, when I saw Danny Burch and Ody Lorcan still doing their tag team shit, when are they gonna get tag titles? But that's another story for another topic. But look, why were they fighting these two guys called Neskid or Neskai guys? You have to see this. Dude, they look like a broken down, cheap Poundland version of the Young Bucks. I'm not even joking. If you saw them, the way they were dressed, they had the vest out, they had the little boots and the little tights. The only thing missing was the tassels. It looked like the Young Bucks. Well, just the Poundland version.
Remember, maybe they were taking a piss, or it is still the developmental kind of, so, yeah.
But they can't be looking like the Young Bucks, I'm sorry. One dude looked like Nick so bad with a few pounds on him. Well, the other guy looked like Matt with a haircut.
Or could they say they were like the Rockers? Which is what the Young Bucks have patted themselves after.
But the Rockers never wore vests.
In the ring, coming to the ring, they did.
No, they had t-shirts.
They had like the cut-off.
Well, you're old enough to remember that. The Rockers weren't my generation, but from what I saw the Rockers in, from when I'm watching clips and videos and shit, I'm seeing t-shirts that you can easily rip off, like your name's Hulk Hogan, and you know what I mean, or No Top, run into the ring. These guys had the jacket, the fucking zebra style shit that the Young Bucks wear in this 21st century time of wrestling. Okay, I'm sorry, but check it out, guys.
I think the last NXT thing that I was actually interested in was when Rhea Ripley was champion. And I think the women's division was fun for a minute. I think that was the last thing that I found entertaining.
I think we need to talk about this right now. Let's talk about this right now.
Go on.
Rhea Ripley, Charlotte Flair, and this NXT title. We need to talk about this.
Charlotte, man. Everywhere. I just can't take it.
I told you Watch. On this channel, maybe when we first started, the first few episodes I started recording, I said to you, in that WrestleMania, remember that WrestleMania triple threat match? Remember after? And we talked, when we were going through the review, Becky and Sasha and Charlotte. And we all thought, oh, maybe Sasha or Bailey will, Becky will win it. Whatever. Point is, I said to you, they are going to make Charlotte the new Ric Flair with the title rings. Okay? She's already won the SmackDown title.
They've been doing that for years. That's nothing new.
No, but my point was, I said that ages ago. I said that years ago, right? How many WrestleManias ago was that?
They were doing that from the beginning, yeah.
No, but my point, but that was my point. And look now. And I told you the same thing about Braun Strowman. Look now. Do you know what I'm saying? It's easily read.
Yeah, but you said Braun was never going to be champion. He,
no, but I said if Braun wasn't going to win the title within a year, he's finished. He won the title 2 years later.
He's being too rude.
Let's remember that.
But Charlotte, man,
yeah, but too much. 2 years later.
Ric Flair was never booked to the point that he was too much. You weren't like, I'm sick of Ric Flair in his heyday. It's different. It's like Charlotte, they just every show.
When you're the only big game town, then it is what it is. Like Ric Flair wasn't like in WCW consistently. He was NWA traveling the world defending that NWA title. Mm. Then the whole WCW, do you know what I mean? And then, you know, he had his stint in WWF back in the day, but I mean, even that, like, he won the title once then, right?
He did win it, yeah.
Yeah, he only won it once.
He went back to WCW and they offered him mad money.
Exactly. Come on, bro.
It was like the one title, like with Flair, was like him just going around, but with her, it's on every, it's just, I think it's just the way she's booked and the character. That's another thing. It's like, is she a,
she needs to stay a heel, though.
Your face,
I can't stand face,
like, she's different everywhere she goes. It's like, she's obviously a
heel.
Looks like all stuck up and talking down to people, but they still kind of try and present her
like, that's cool.
It's a mess.
Yeah, it's a big, like, look, her being stuck up and all that, okay, that's cool. I don't mind that. That's just cool. Stay a heel.
And book her.
Yes, exactly. And when she loses, she needs to go nuts. She needs to go crazy. Okay? It's as simple as that. Not rub it off like, oh, I'm still Charlotte. No, she needs to go nuts. Okay? Yeah. Even though she kicked the crap out of Rhea Ripley and Io Shirai after them. Was it after a tournament? I can't remember. Do you know what I'm saying? So, as far as I'm concerned, that's what they need to be doing.
But yeah, I was into it. No. While Rhea was champ, I was liking that. I like Rhea.
Yeah.
Once she lost it, I just kind of, that was the last thing I was really into. And I love, you know, I love Adam Cole. I love, you know, all the other guys. But for some reason, their stories weren't interesting to me.
Well, you kind of knew what was going to happen with those. Sorry, a little bit technical difficulties. But you kind of knew what was going to happen with those guys. Anyways, I mean, with Adam Cole, I mean, how far can you push the Undisputed Era? They were going to get boring sooner or later, right?
But if you come up with decent stories for them, then there's no reason for that. But they just kind of...
But what else could you do? I mean, you're going to have to do a split. You're going to have to do a split within the faction now. I mean, or push Keith... Let Keith Lee drop the title to someone else. My life, pal. This is what happened. I don't know. My systems all crashed. But literally, am I still here? Yeah, we're still here. All right, cool. So I had to, my charger just, but anyways. Yeah,
just to come up with other stories for other members, ain't necessarily got to split them off, but at least give Roddy some proper story to do something.
Roddy's just the fool guy, though. He's always been that guy.
It doesn't have to be. That's what I'm saying. Write it. Come up with
stories. But Roddy has no, I'm not going to lie to you. I feel Roddy has no personality within the group, right? Him and Bobby Fish are the weakest, are the only guys for me that don't really have personality.
Mm.
Kyle O'Reilly is funny as fuck. Mm. Adam Cole is funny as fuck. Bobby Fish, he can be when he wants to be. Let's be honest.
But
Roddy is just like, he's like early Kurt Angle. I got to keep it 100. Early Kurt Angle. I love Kurt Angle later on, but like that first year of Kurt Angle, let's be honest, man, he weren't really like. No, but he got better over time. And I loved Angle. He got there quick.
Roddy was right when he was first beefing with Velveteen.
For me, Roddy's more of a face, man. You can't have him as a heel.
Like, he's no interest as a face at all for me, man.
But as a heel, I don't really find it interesting. Mm. I mean, I don't know. That's just ever each to our own, isn't it? But I don't really find him as fascinating with a heel. If he's going to be a heel, he needs to stand out on his own. It's like Gargano right now. I mean, I'm all right with the heel Gargano, but at the same time, I don't really...
Hey, fuck that
I don't know.
Yeah, yeah, fuck that whole thing up. Sean Paul, Gargano.
Yeah, but Gargano stayed on NXT for too long. This is why.
Not even that. I don't, that ain't my opinion. I think he should always stay there because there's nothing for him on... In the main
no, 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 no. There isn't. There isn't.
Jumper. And Candice, I mean, they fucked her up from the get-go. They've just not got her right at all.
No, they never bothered. She's too small, remember?
Small?
They even did it with the women. They even did it with the women. Let's be honest. They are. Small. They really are.
Huh?
They really are doing it with the women. She is too small. She is.
How?
I mean, I feel like they're looking at it like... I'm only saying it from what you would say when it comes to the men.
Yeah, but you don't. That doesn't apply to the women. She's skilled. She has more skill than most of the women there.
Then why did Rhea Ripley get the belt before her?
Because she had the momentum. She had the personality. Candice hasn't really displayed.
How did Bianca Belair at one point? She ain't touched the belt.
Because they just didn't recognize. Because for some reason it worked when she was on the Indies. Her personality, this cutesy. They were able. The people independently, especially PWG, they were able to take advantage of that. Girl next door, everyone loves her sort of vibe. But NXT, they never really got that. They never knew how, they didn't really understand how to book that.
And it's like Candice.
She could have been a great Bayley. Like they got it right with Bayley. When Bayley was there, they got it right with her.
Yeah, but Bayley was there in her own creation. You have to remember that.
Yeah,
I mean, yeah, Bayley did the Indies.
It's like that though, man. But it's be different than what Vince does on the main
roster. It's WWE. Look how many times they put... Remember, let's really think about it, yeah? Forget Goldberg. Booker T is probably the most pushed ex-WCW star to ever come to WWE. Let's be honest.
Push.
I love Booker T, but still, let's be real.
Push.
Let's be real. Let's be real. Look, Goldberg came, Kevin Nash came, Scott Hall came. All them dudes came. Booker T was the only one pushed properly. Even some things I'm a bit...
Push to lose. I don't
compared to Scott Steiner... Compared to Scott Steiner, come on. Compared to Kevin Nash, even though he kept getting injured. Compared to Goldberg, I mean, they messed him up from even when he first came in. The first run of Goldberg, they messed up.
Again, it's right. Let's keep it about the Candice, though. They messed her up.
No, I'm just showing you the point, though. Yeah, I know. I'm just showing you the point.
Could have been better than what she is.
They'd rather create their own.
That's what I'm
saying.
They'd
rather create their own. Yeah, but I don't
that
know.
Stupid mentality, but, you know, it's fucked up.
Well, man.
How do you feel about what's been going on with Bayley? Because we weren't really doing this when she first turned ill. You be liking it, innit?
I was. Now I'm a bit. I'm getting a bit bored. It's getting a bit too
ain't really working.
Obvious that Sasha's gonna turn, but it's like when. But it's not. It's not that when. You know when your heart. It's like. I don't know. I remember when Shawn Michaels was working for JBL and we were all waiting for Shawn Michaels. Like, hurry up. Come on, let's do it. Like, even though we know, like, we're thinking ahead, Shawn Michaels has made so much bloody money. Why is he working for JBL? Da-da-da-da-da-da. But they had a story to back that up. Yeah, Shawn Michaels spent too much money over the years. Da-da-da-da-da. Now he needs JBL, the big shot rich guy that's like on the stock market, blah, 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 right? Mm. They had enough story for that. But and we waited for that. We were waiting for Shawn Michaels. But, and he never actually did it. The blow-off was good. But when you look at this, it's like Sasha Banks was kind of losing that little... she was losing it. It was boring because they kept booking her. Her and Charlotte, women's title. Every Raw, she wins the title of Charlotte. Pay-per-view, she loses it.
She was away for months, and then they built up her comeback, and then what's happened? She's just hanging out with...
And she's just...
The valet.
The blueprint. Remember? The blueprint is back
valet.
In Bayley's corner.
The valet that
in Bayley's corner.
Fucking so bad.
And let's get into this, yeah? Because I know we're not going to talk about Money in the Bank, but the match that Bayley had with Tamina, oh my God. What annoyed me was the finish. And you see Sasha Banks getting halfway in the ring, looked like she was going to stop. And then Tamina just does the stupid gullible face thing. Oh, what? You want something? Bayley. That was it. That was it. Yeah. And you think to yourself, are we really doing this?
Yeah.
And then Charlotte has a promo on Raw when someone actually bothered, because when they have sleepless nights during coronavirus, this is what happened, guys. We actually watch Raw, unfortunately. And then Charlotte goes, oh, so what? Are you going to be acceptable being her lapdog? What happened to the session? You know those promos. And it's like, come on.
Who do you Charlotte think has done this whole empty arena thing best? For me, AEW being...
Who's done it best?
Yeah, AEW have done it way better, in my opinion, by having the heels on the outside. It's still not as good as obviously having a crowd, but it adds...
They got a few people there to cheer.
It adds some energy.
That's something. Yeah. And besides, I'm more interested in the stories of AEW, sorry, not AEW. Like, earlier I saw Moxley put the guy in, like, was it Brody Lee's number 10 guy who he's said, yeah, this is my guy. Brody Lee just used him as sacrifice. Like, all right, well, we got to do what we got to do. We're going to leave. All of them left with Moxie's title. Moxie was like, well, I'm going to break this guy's arm. I said it. I'm going to do it. And he broke his arm. I was still into that.
You know what's going on with that? You know what I'm saying? The dudes are stuck in Canada, innit?
Huh?
The guys are stuck in Canada, innit?
Oh, yeah.
Why they haven't been there? That's why they're using...
I don't know what happened to those guys.
Yeah, that's why they're using the minions to... Evil Uno and what's-his-face. That's why they're using the minions to cover it all. So, yeah.
I'd rather that, though, because you can't have the other two, because they were fucking gravy when it first started. I was like... I still like the Dark Order.
You're the only one. Everyone hated the fucking Dark Order. I was not lying.
No, I like the Dark Order. Especially the little minions where they just...
Oh, they were
terrible. That's fucking jokes.
They just look so cheap. That
was fucking hilarious. The way they just scatter, like...
Dude, I don't even like Brody
Lee. It's hilarious.
Let's actually get on to Brody Lee. I don't like his get-up. I'm all right with him.
But the whole Vince McMahon type of thing, I mean...
The garments just look... I don't know. Can't you do it better? Like, it's like the costume designer for...
It is Vince. They're trying to do Vince. That's what it is.
No, that's in the suit. But I mean, his wrestling shit. With the weird... But crappy.
What else can you wear?
Just make it better. I mean, a better costume designer, man. Just make some better shit. This is good.
I don't know. I don't really have an opinion on that. I mean, it is what it is.
You think it looks bad for AEW that their headliner, the main event, is basically a WWE main event?
But I mean, WCW did that, and they made a whole bunch of money.
Yeah, but look at what WCW was. You think
this really is
for the company?
And you got to remember, WWE did that as well with WCW characters too.
Like with with a whole WCW main event?
They've had a few WCW guys main event. They've had a WWE guy, but two. But still, they had the WCW guy go over the WWE guy. Which is, Vince always likes to bury WCW wrestlers.
Yeah, but there's no secret about AEW, though. You think this is a good look?
Yeah, I know.
You think they should have had their own, at least one of their own guys big enough to do this?
But they built their company, they kind of built the title around Moxley. Even though Jericho had it and he kind of gave it some proper. And I know Jericho is more solidified with WWE, but he was WCW originally. Let's not forget that. New Japan, ECW, etc. Even though most people later on kind of was like, WWF Jericho.
Average, regular guy at home. They don't really remember WCW shit. So they just see WWE champion, another WWE champion. Now he's getting challenged by an ex-WWE mid-carder. Ain't a good look, man. I don't think.
No, but who else? But you just said it, like you said earlier in the show. Would you rather Cody be the champion? No, it's not going to look good. Kenny Omega, it's not going to look good. The Young Bucks,
whoever it is that he's challenging, that's going up against him in Double Nothing, doesn't have to win, but it'd be good if they had one of their own guys. Brody ain't beat
like him. Who?
He could have built up someone else to do that.
But who? Who? I'm asking you. Who? Who? Name me someone.
How long has Brody been there first?
He ain't been there that long. You're right.
Really?
You're right. I agree.
If they'd done Wardlow right, could they have done him up better?
Nah, he just looks too Ryback-ish, man. Nah.
Yeah, you're saying that because they haven't built up his character. So you just think of how he looks rather than what he could have been, his potential.
Oh, they dropped what? The match with him and Cody. He's too right backish. I'm sorry. He's
they dropped the ball on him, man. And then, who else?
No, he just ain't the guy. I'm sorry. You might as well go get Brian Cage. Is it going to be the same thing? Come on. Is it going to be the same thing?
I know Brian Cage was injured, but they never made it official that he was AEW, did they?
No.
They never got to that point. It was right there. They were going to do it, then he got hurt.
Mm.
Now we don't know what the fuck's going on.
But even if...
They need him, man.
I don't know what's going on with that. They should have brought Flip in as well, but... I know Flip wants to do his own thing, which is good.
Flip's too loyal, though, man. Flip's too loyal to Scroll. I know. And Scroll's basically running Ring of Honor now, which is crazy to think.
He's still messing with NWA, isn't he?
Yeah.
Both of them are.
Yeah, but Scroll books Ring of Honor now, which is mad. It's so crazy. He's basically Ring of Honor's... I'm not going to say he's their Cody yet, because he hasn't given himself the belt or nothing, but... Weird. It's a shame, though.
Yeah, well, the elite run the world like NWO in the 90s. Or the Click in the 90s. Let's be real.
Man, everyone.
The Click in the 90s. Same thing.
Let's get on to Becky, man. How do you feel? Becky finally stepping away.
I'm happy for her. I really am. Even though I was, like, not fan with, you know, let's be honest, because, like, obviously we're crashing, like, Becky's heart, whatever, right? But, I mean, with Rollins, we're like, oh, I don't know. How long is this going to last? Da, 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 da. But regardless, I'm happy for them both.
Yeah, I didn't want to do it.
I'm happy for them both, man. No, I didn't know. And then we saw that whole picture with them, like, engaged from way back when. When was that? Oh, like, a year. I don't know if it was a year yet, but way back. And then now we're hearing this. I'm fucking happy for them. I'm happy. I couldn't be more happy for them.
It's beautiful good, timing because I was... Look,
Becky Rise,
I was behind because I always liked Becky.
Always behind.
Fan of Becky, and I was like, yeah, finally, she's getting a due. She deserves it. But once she was there, and they ran out of ideas for her, and this whole demand thing started.
I was gonna get the T-shirt. I still might.
I just did not like it. There was no direction for it. It was just repeating itself. I'm the man. She started doing the whole Conor McGregor.
They gave her the Stone Cold Steve Austin Attitude Era 1998.
But they weren't doing it right. They weren't doing it good. They were just doing the most generic elements of it rather than...
That's because they didn't book. That's because when you think about the most credible wrestlers for her to face, or superstars in this case, Shayna was already buried, dead. They didn't try, but didn't help her out. How many times do we want to see Charlotte Flair? Sasha Banks went missing. Remember, she was injured. And we didn't really want to see Bayley versus Becky. Let's be honest.
Other
than that.
The other women, though, that shows you how bad their writing has been. Because, like I said, you can't really make excuses at who they're going to do when they could have just written other characters better and make them credible.
But again, like I said, mud sticks, okay? We all know, for example, we'll probably talk about the Iconics in a bit, though they might get a mention. But remember, they won the titles, they come, they disappear, they drop the titles, disappear for a bit, come back, they don't even look that credible anymore.
Yeah,
they didn't look credible in the beginning. What's it gonna do? Put a Peyton Royce in a ring with Becky Lynch for the title. No one's gonna take that seriously.
Championship belts, and they hate the women's one even more.
They hate women's wrestling in general.
They just
hate. Let's just be honest. The whole women's revolution was all because the whole AJ Lee thing went spiral, and at that time they weren't messing with neither of them, right? And then they gave it to Nikki Bella, who was the face of the women's division at that point, before Charlotte come along, right? Well, she was there, but before they started giving Charlotte the push, right? And then everyone, again, it goes back to the whole 80s era of the big macho thing, and then no one likes that. We all want the small guys like Bret, Shawn Michaels, etc. The same thing for women.
Small guys like Bret. I want my wrestlers roided up. I want them to be like action figures.
Fuck that, man. Everyone I want my guys to be.
Everyone stiff. Wants them to be. That's why don't they get like over quicker.
So, I don't know about everyone.
That's why Brian Cage is such a needed commodity for AEW, because he looks like a fucking He-Man
figure. No, Brian Cage could do other stuff, which I'm fine with.
Yeah, I'm not saying exclusive. I'm not saying be big, but be a shit wrestler. I'm saying still got to be a good wrestler. But two wrestlers, exactly the same skill level, but one's skinny like Sami Zayn, and the other one looks like Brian Cage. Who do you think is going to be more popular in the public eye?
Obviously, the guy you're related with the most.
Oh, it's going to be Cage. He's going to be one that people want to see on a talk show. He's going to be the one that people tune in to see, like, wow, I want to see this guy.
No, of course, I get that. No, I'm not saying I don't get that. But what I'm saying is, you got other people that want to be wrestlers. They're not going to be looking like bracket. They already accept that.
I'm talking about average audience. People want to be wrestlers is like 10% of people watching wrestling, if that.
Yeah, that's because wrestling is trash right now. Let's be honest. It's not as it was in the 90s or the early 2000s.
General regular sitting at home public. They don't want people who look like them. They want people who look better than them.
So tell me, why did Daniel Bryan get such a big push back when he did?
That good. He's that good.
Of course he's that good. That's but look good how small he is.
He's one of the few outliers that can transcend being, you know, not being a 6'5" guy. He's one of the few that can get over it. And that's all right. There's always a few. It's fine. But when it's everybody, then it sucks.
Stone Michael.
Yeah.
Stone Cold wasn't even that big.
He's like 6'1", 6'2". That's big enough.
Ah, oh, come on, man. He wasn't that big. He wasn't Hulk Hogan big.
He was in good enough shape.
A little stomach.
Oh, come on, man. You can't say that. I won't say that.
But compare him. All right, tell me this. Compare him to stunning Steve Austin in the WCW.
Go off the juice. Start drinking more beer. That beer, man. That fucking beer.
But you're still.
He wasn't Kevin Owens. And I think Kevin Owens works for him. Some people it can work for. I think Kevin Owens looks, it suits him with the t-shirt on. If he was wearing like a singlet like he used to do back in the day, it would not work.
So, Mick Foley wore a singlet as well, but people didn't know. Unless you watched WCW earlier on in the night.
I wouldn't have done it. When he became Mankind, that's when I was like, oh, I like this guy. Because they found the right look. Look is important, man. It's important.
No, of course it is. I just feel like, you know, we're in an era now where it's acceptable. It's 100 times acceptable. Some people still want the Dark Ages. They still want the Ultimate Warriors looking ass.
Give me steroids.
They still want the Hulk Hogan.
But listen, for me,
don't get me wrong, okay? I like those jacked up, rodded up dudes too. But you have to move.
Yeah.
If you can't move, you ain't got me as a fan.
Of course. Exclusive. All right? You still need to perform in the ring.
You still need to be doing frog splashes. You need to be doing... Do you know what I'm saying? Look at Apollo Crews. He ain't got the best charisma. We all know that. But the guy can move.
That's right, but he's just not got the personality. That's what's his problem.
And that's the problem. And it's kind of hard for most of these wrestlers. They haven't got the charisma, the personality. They got the look. They can have the look. They can have the skill set. Oh, wow, you can do a flip. Wow. Like, dude, I remember seeing Brock Lesnar do a shooting star back in the day. I was like,
of course. Nearly
killing. That's a kid. I was like, what the hell was this? This is nuts.
Yeah, and he was impressive because he was a fucking beast because he looked like a machine. That's why it was impressive.
Yeah, but now I can't look at... Now I look at... You're a shell of your old self, honestly. I can't deal with it, honestly. I just feel, for me, there's a little barrier, but...
You reckon?
I think we're way off topic. We've gone off, though.
Do you reckon Becky's ever going to come back?
I don't know. But even if she does, I mean, is there a point? Not saying because she's getting a kid now, but I mean, she's kind of done everything, isn't it?
Yeah, probably not. Well, she's in a mid-30s. She's getting on a bit. You know, she's at a point, I think 32. She's at a point now, have the kid. It's probably a good time to do it.
Yeah, this is pretty much the perfect time.
In her hands. Will she want to come back?
Maybe she will do like a stint or show up in a Royal Rumble or something.
Yeah, inevitable.
Maybe one of those.
Definitely.
Like an Edge comeback. That was, oh my God. I'm sorry. I have to get this off my chest. We didn't even record then. That And I had work the next day. Dude, I fucking killed it at like 3-4 o'clock in the morning. I was screwing my head off. Like, I didn't even wake my mother up or whatnot, bro. I was going absolutely nuts for Edge. But I knew it was happening, though. This is me. I knew it was going to happen. But I still, like, had to suspend my relief, bro. I'm sorry. I just wanted to get it off my chest.
You're a big Edge head, isn't it, back in the day?
Of course, I was. Wasn't a massive Edge head, but I love Edge. I always had soft spot for Edge. Edge was one of my guys, like, you know what I'm saying? You know, you got your pack when you're a kid. You got your pack of wrestlers you always get behind. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because I like
Edge in the tag team. I'm not really that big fan of him solo.
Right. Fair enough. I mean, the whole Rated R Superstar thing, that was me, man. When the whole, when his music changed, I was like, yes, this is the shit. And then we beat Cena. I was like, yeah. I remember, I like Cena. Remember that? But when I saw Edge beating for the title at New Year's Revolution, cashed in that money in the bank, I was like, yeah, oh my God, it's going to do it. I said, there was fan reactions back then. Oh my God.
Let's not get too far into the weeds, because we've been going for a little while now. So let's breeze over Wrestling with Shadows this season.
Okay. Wrestling with Shadows. This is not a Bret Hart documentary. You mean Dark Side of the Ring.
Oh, Dark Side of the Ring.
That says the Bret Hart. Fuck. We're going to talk about the Bret Hart.
Hey, Dark Side of Shadows.
We can talk about that if you want.
It's all about being in the dark, man. It's all good. Yeah. Dark Side of the Ring, season 2, and Undertaker Last Ride, so far.
Yeah.
2 seasons in, as of recording now, 2 episodes. Mm-hmm. So, what have you thought about Dark Side so far? I saw the Owen Hart one earlier.
I mean, I don't know. It really...
How do they get WWE footage? Because they're not showing the company in the good light. Is there, like, fair use? So they only using a certain amount? But there's so much of it, you have to think that they have to get permission. That's what's baffling me. Because they ain't showing WWE in a good light. So it's amazing that they ain't like, stop showing our shit.
True. Now I kind of think about it. True. But at the same time, I mean, I don't know. I really don't know. Because
how did it?
The way I feel about WWE now has been even more concerning than I felt in the first place. Listen, let's not beat up the average viewer. It's not all fairy tales and Tinkerbells and Disneyland and all this shit.
Foundational.
There's too much stuff.
It's a foundation of evil and sacrifice babies. That's what WWE is based on, man.
And when I first met this guy, ladies and gentlemen, this guy was not watching wrestling, and he even said to me, especially WWE, Vince McMahon was evil. I said, you know what? I'm not going to lie to you. I'm not too keen on Vince, but I'm not going to crap on him from all the shit that he made me watch as a youngster up to an adult.
And if you're like, why is Vince evil? Why is WWE evil? Then you ain't been in this.
You need to watch the series.
You ain't, not even that. You just ain't been watching wrestling, period. I don't just mean the certain shows. You ain't be following what's going on behind.
No, they've been hypnotized. Because
if you don't know, they be fucked up for a long time.
Listen, like, I was fucked up too.
Dark Side of the Ring, it's been good though. Superfly was good. The only one I skipped was the Slapping Report one, because I just ain't really interested in that guy.
Yeah, you didn't really, I'm not going to lie, you didn't really miss much. I mean, the guy is just pissed off about it now. So, I mean, yeah, whatever.
Really feel like
you know what I mean? The guy got screwed over. The Schultz guy did get screwed over. I mean, he did get screwed over pretty bad. I mean, Vince said he will look after me, didn't
he? Why? He wasn't a big guy. He wasn't a name, so why would they go out of
the way? No, but the thing with him, he was supposed to be like the big heel for Hulk Hogan to battle like around WrestleMania 1 and shit. But because Hulk Hogan was doing good shit with him on the indies because he was so controversial and stuff. And Hogan even told Vince, you need to bring Schultz in. He can bring us money. Because they were doing good shit on the indies at the time. But obviously, the whole slap thing happened. And then
they realized we got Roddy Piper and we don't need this guy.
Like Roddy Piper's got... Listen, man. And Roddy Piper, I need to say, it's Roddy Piper.
Roddy Piper.
Listen, Roddy Piper. I hear you. I hear you. And I don't want to disagree with you because he is, but I got my bones with Roddy as well, you know. I'm not gonna lie. There's a couple of things I've watched.
Yeah, you talk about the whole black half life. That's the next year. Let's stick with.
Yeah, we'll talk about that another time, innit?
But a good show.
I don't know how I feel about
Roddy. Legion of Doom, Road Warriors episode. I really love because I loved Road Warriors as a kid. Real sad.
That was a good episode.
To hear that, to see more, to find out more about the behind the scenes of that descent. That
That SummerSlam one though. Oh my! Dude, I mean.
Real sad.
A good year. I was born that year as well, but I watched that match before.
High as fuck, riding a motorbike.
The thing is, I've watched that pay-per-view before. And sometimes I like to go back on the network and watch all the old shit. But I mean, to know he was high as fuck, and like you just said, riding that motorcycle. And remember, they were supposed to have a tag team title match. Sorry?
Still got a network?
Nah, not anymore. I did. I only had it for pay-per-views because obviously my brother was like, "Oh, I want to watch it. I want to stop watch it on those sites." But you know, we're not gonna bring up the sites now. Come on. But yeah. So, anyways, long story short, I mean, it was very disappointing to hear they had a tag team title match. I never knew this, obviously, because I wasn't watching. Obviously, I wasn't even alive for like a few months later. But I mean, come on, man, to know they had a tag title match and then. They got that taken away because Hawk was too off his rocker. Like, dude, that's terrible.
The last star back in the day, and he just, some people, they just go deep. They have to go deep.
I know. Yeah. And then he turned his life around, and it was just too late, man.
Too much damage in it. Damage was done. Just dropped dead. It's crazy, man.
A lot of these wrestlers have been through it. The Dino Bravo one, it wasn't even Dino Bravo. I think the Gino one was the most eerie
that's
one for me.
I'm going to go back to that. Fullback season.
Totally. All right. That was season one. But, dude, that was eerie as fuck. But, yeah, what else was in season two? What else was in season two?
Benoit.
That one was tough for me.
I wasn't
very tough for me.
I wasn't expecting to like this because I figured what is left for there to know, like. And it wasn't really anything new, but
it was a few things.
Presenting it in a way that just had it all together and having the people, you know.
I loved it. I'm not going to lie. And the only reason why I loved it because I think back to when I was in secondary school and I learned the news, I was like, what? We just lost Eddie. I got a tear in my eye back then. Do you know what I mean? I even had a tear in my eye watching this, I'll be real. Because for me, I was a Benoit fan, and like to know what he did, and even revisiting it is a bit like still a bit cold and raw that I have to feel. But seeing Daniel, seeing Nancy's sister, hearing the ins and outs of Benoit and Nancy's relationship, like even during that time, and even before we even saw the development of Kevin Sullivan, and even though Kevin Sullivan didn't want to be on it, but regardless of that, and hearing from Chris. Hearing from Vicky Guerrero, Chavo, even giving us a little bit of the Eddie story as well, because that definitely was a cornerstone to Chris Benoit.
Yeah, that pushed him over the edge.
Yeah, it broke him. That was it. For me, that was it. That was the final nail in the coffin, yeah? And then seeing Daniel on there as well, reunited with his aunt-in-law, like, dude, that was probably one of the best moments I've seen on that show. That was a beautiful moment still. You know what I mean? But, I don't know, man. It was tough because I wanted to hear their side as well. She even said, maybe one day she'll eventually forgive him, but obviously he's just, I don't know, man. I don't think I could forgive him. He's one of my favorite dudes. And then he's on that, it's like,
yeah.
And then hearing the small thing about Lewinsky, maybe that could have been a difference maker as well because that sprung into my mind. Christopher Lewinsky, Benoit spoke to him about concussions. Then when Lewinsky called him, Benoit was having an argument with Nancy, and then he said he'll get back to him, and then he never got back, and then they never had that conversation.
That's crazy, man, because, CTE, that's when people really started, that's around the time people really started taking that shit seriously, man.
Because again, you kind of think about the wellness policy in WWE back then, it's just so trash. Oh, God. Maybe we could have. Maybe Eddie could have been saved. Maybe Benoit could have been saved. We'll never know.
It wasn't even that wellness. Well, in pace with Eddie, it wasn't even about like steroids. It was about with Eddie. It was like painkillers and shit because of the disability.
Yeah, but still,
and with
you could still find out if your heart's bad or not.
It was all the concussions, all the head shit, all the fucking his brain was mush.
True, but again. They didn't have concussion tests. They weren't doing it then, properly. If they'd have found out, they would have probably told Benoit, listen, you need to retire. It's as simple as that. Okay. Or Eddie, you need to retire because your heart is very, very bad. Okay?
Yeah, too much fucking them pain pills, man. Just fucks you up. But, yeah.
But, I don't know. But Owen, we need to talk about this, yeah. Because this was, this came on the other day, which, you know, I was watching, Brian Alvarez earlier, and he was kind of saying he felt kind of funny about it airing the same day as finding out about Shad Gaspar. Eerie. And even, remember I even said to you when I, well, we didn't really touch on it. I said, oh yeah, let's wait till we're here. Like, and I said to you, did you find it eerie when Owen spoke to Oge and he said, take care of your mother and your sister. And then when you put the Shad thing together, Shad was kind of like, you know, you say my son's type of, like, yo, that's kind of eerie. I'm not saying it's conspiracy, dude. But
I bet he said
I kind of get that.
Whenever
yeah, he but I mean,
he said that to his boy all the time. But
do you think he said it to him all the time? Oh, he kind of spoke. It's kind of said it like, okay, but the way Oge came across, was like he didn't really say it, like he's never really told him that before.
I guess that's more significant because it's the last time, so it's always going to be that's the last words his dad said to him, so it's always going to be way
but
more.
I'm sure Oge would have remembered if he said it to him every single time and he specifically requested to take. I don't know, it just sounded weary. And JR even said Owen seemed off that day.
Yeah, but, I mean, nah.
It's weird though, man.
It's shit. And in the fuck is. It's just shitty that this big ass company was just cutting corners like that.
They make me sick.
Yeah, you didn't want to spend that little extra money by getting proper experts in. They just figured, get some guy to use a fucking.
They weren't doing it. And the thing is, they've done it before.
Mad. And they kept the show.
They've done it before.
That was mad hearing them talk about, because I knew that the show went on.
Yeah, it did.
But
my friend had it on tape.
We were hearing him talk about how there was a dent in the ring. You could feel the dent as you were walking on it.
I never noticed that.
And there was blood as well there. And they just kept on.
I never noticed that either.
This is your boy that just died. You know that he's dead. Everyone knows at this point. And they're still fucking wrestling and getting slammed. And they can see the blood. They can see the dent. Dude, I would have fucking walked out, man. I'd be like, fuck you, man. My boy's just, nah. Show must go on.
My boy's just died. And this excuse, Owen would have, fuck you, fuck you. But Owen would have wanted it to continue. It's no, because if Owen's saying, get out the way on his way down, is that a man saying, I want it to continue? Yeah, to Jimmy Corderas. Like, come on, bro.
It's a circumstance. If it was like, remember when King had a heart attack?
Yeah.
If that had happened at the event.
I teared for that as well.
If that had happened in the middle of an event and they taking him away, I can understand carrying on with the show. It's something that you don't really have control over. It's sad, but it's different than a big accident like what Owen went through. It's different. That should not have carried on. It's different. It's not the type of trauma that you're witnessing. That crowd, people, the fucking tens of thousands of people just watched the guy die.
Exactly.
Even at most
that will stay. Most in their minds forever.
Most of them didn't realize it was real. And I remember them hearing stories that a lot of people were still cheering. I think I did see the event when it was airing. They cut that off because there was a delay on the feed. But I do remember that a lot of people were still cheering. They didn't realize it was legit. They thought it was just some stunt, which is dumb. How can you can't fake someone falling from the fucking roof of an arena. But
it's funny you say the cheering because, like I said, when I watched this years ago, honestly, I didn't watch it like live. I wasn't watching wrestling for like a good another year, like properly. But my friend used to record pay per views. Like when I watched it on his VHS, you heard the cheering and the claps and that. I'm pretty sure. Sorry, hay fever. I'm pretty sure it was like probably the EMTs on that putting Owen on the stretcher and probably wheeling him out. That's probably what the claps and the cheers were for. I don't know.
Even when he saw the footage of JR updating people.
Oh, man.
You see the people behind him and they're still like in the shot doing all the like, yay, whoa, woo, woo. They don't know.
Yeah, true. Maybe some people just didn't understand what was going on to the statue.
Yeah. But yeah.
But again, that's fucked up. But yeah. The clip, Ed, we need to talk about the clip. That budget clip that Mark was still calling. Clip.
Some bullshit to cut corners.
What the hell is that?
Because they wanted it to be quicker because they didn't like the whole fiddling to get off of the harness. So they wanted it to be a quick. That's Vince there.
Because I remember watching one when he came down off one, the proper one, and then he was hanging like a... I actually remember watching that one. He was hanging like a piñata and Steve Blackman was supposed to fight him. And I actually remember watching that one of the old Raws.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, that's kind of... That's fine. Just, why didn't you just keep that? Why didn't you just keep that?
Because
just a little cheap thing.
Yeah, but with Vince, he's like, I want him to be able to hit the floor and go. But you couldn't do
that. Yeah, but...
Because it was a lot of
fun. But I was watching, and again, when this is what Brian Alvarez said as well, and it made so much sense. The thing, when you look at, and obviously we all know it was supposed to be a parody of Sting, right? But when you looked at Sting doing it, the NWO guys stood back, waited for Sting to take the harness off, regardless of how shitty it looked. Regardless, yeah. It still made people go, do you know what I mean?
They don't remember that bit. They only remember the dramatic descent.
They just remember the drop down.
You look back here, you only remember him coming down, not remember him sitting there fiddling with it.
I'll give you the best thing. Remember that time the NWO were beating the shit out of DDP because DDP didn't join them, right? And then Sting come and saved them. Sting carried him off in the harness. Look how unsafe that shit was.
I don't even remember that.
But guess what? They used to say, yeah, probably don't. But look, they used the same safe harness. DDP went up safely, right?
It's a lot of weight. A lot of weight.
Carb.
But works. But Vince got to cut corners, man. Don't give a fuck. And you see him at the press
conference
making excuses. And they sued.
I thought so.
And they sued the wife.
Apparently because of a breach of contract. Nah, man. You killed her husband.
They wanted to move the case to Connecticut because in Connecticut, there's no liability.
There's no liability. Yeah.
Yeah. That's so fucking...
That's trash. That's so trash. And apparently they all thought, oh, well, they want money. No.
What shocked me, though? What I didn't know.
The Hart.
This I knew. What shocked me is that the Hart family...
That pissed me off.
Not behind. They were like, don't sue the... No, we may need to... Because they don't know what the future may hold. Basically, because the only other Hart member, the only member of that family to still wrestle after that is Natalie. So all of this is for Natty to fucking wrestle with her dog shit career.
Well, and David Boy. And David Boy Jr.
He was already there, though.
No, Junior.
Oh, yeah, but he was shit. Come on. David Boy.
Yeah, but they didn't know. Yeah, but we didn't know that at the time. He was a little kid at the time. Come on, yeah, let's be real. Him, Natalia... Like, even Tyson Kidd, he was pretty much all right. He was always around them. You know what I mean? Even before he got married. You know what I mean? Yes. Like, you know, it's terrible. Is Teddy related to them? I don't know.
Yeah.
Teddy what? He is, isn't it?
Yeah, he is.
He's never talked about it. I don't know why. But regardless of that, like, and then the thing that made me laugh, because there's an interview, Meltzer actually talks to Martha Hart, right? And I watched this last night. I didn't even get to send it to you. I'll send it to you later. And they were going over it. And apparently, and this hurt me because, you know, I love Brett. This hurt me. Apparently, Brett even asked Martha to try and get some of his footage. And remember, during this time, Brett wasn't cool with Vince. Mm. During this time, apparently, Brett wanted some footage, his own footage to get off during the, you know what I'm saying? And it's absolutely crazy.
What, he wanted footage of the drop?
No, he actually wanted, his own wrestling footage. He wanted his library, basically.
Oh.
Included in one of the lawsuits. I don't know how to feel about it.
Yeah, that really put a downer in my mouth. That kind of, I lost a bit of respect for the Hart family for that. Show that they weren't behind her. So that's basically, she's just completely separated herself. That's why the kids hate wrestling because of, you know, what happened. So they never.
Well, they took their dad. The wrestling took their daddy away. That was what Athena said. So never, and I don't blame her for thinking like that. Do you know what I'm saying?
And it's ironic, man, because they got the look. They look like their dad, but they've got the look. They got the height. Went to the gym, bulked up. Like, they could have been something, man. But
well, I don't know about Athena. Maybe Oj. He looks exactly like Owen, like that. Like that. But I don't know. I feel like it may be hate. I feel like this whole series, not just the Owen Hart thing, but the whole series makes you really look at WWE like
you guys
are even more worse.
What they present to you, you're able to see past it and see like, oh, the ugly.
Did you hear their statement? They posted up because it came out on CBS News the other week. Did you hear their statement? Apparently, one of the lawyers came out and basically said, oh, during that time, Martha only wanted to know about the money or this, that, and the third. She didn't really, like, work really asking full in depth about what's going to happen, what happened to Owen, when Martha basically straightened it out. And if Vince has the goal, I'm going to bring this up, the press conference, I'm going to bring it up in a second, but when Martha talked about, Vince had the goal to be like, oh, I don't know what's happened. Why don't you tell the woman the fucking truth?
You didn't want to be the one to break the news, so you just passed it off to the doctor, innit?
It's ridiculous.
You knew Owen was dead by that.
He told her he fell.
He knew when he was laying in the ring, but fuck it.
Had he died on the way to the hospital, he was still breathing in the ring. On the way to the hospital, he died. I heard that years ago. But that is ridiculous. And, you know, I know a lot of people crap on Jeff Jarrett. But Jeff Jarrett was the only one that went to the hospital with him. And Jeff Jarrett made his way back. Because Jeff Jarrett had a fucking match. Dude, I told Vince, fuck you, I ain't wrestling. My best friend just fell, fam. You're mad.
Then
my tag partner just fell, bro.
Let's get on the flip side of this, how something that's independent shows the ugly underbelly of WWE, but then you watch something which is produced by WWE as in Undertaker's Last Ride.
And it
completely shows a completely different side of Vince. It makes you think that Vince is like this, he ain't so bad. He's a loving, his father figure. They make him look so good, him and Undertaker.
He's old now. Vince is old now. He can do that now. He's a granddaddy.
Yeah, but Undertaker's talking about his entire career that this guy's been his dad, basically. He has.
He's raised him. He has raised him still. But, I mean,
it's a good documentary, The Last Ride. Even though, you know, it's covering up.
I love the other people.
They're redacting some history with some of it. Even with the commentary, some of the commentary you can hear, it's like it's overlaid that it wasn't the original commentary. Like they say, Undertaker, the greatest superstar ever. They didn't say that originally, but I can forgive that. It's still interesting to see. I battled with wanting to watch this because I loved the Undertaker character in the early days. I didn't like him come in the last 8 years. I haven't been that interested. But purple gloves, grey gloves, Undertaker, the shit. I could tolerate early badass Undertaker, but American badass, but it's the early shit I was into. I didn't want that aura to be broken in my head. So to see him as this broken man who can barely walk. You see him at the beginning before he had the hip replacement.
Oh, it hurts.
Yeah.
But dude, I was moaning on for 2 years I was moaning on the podcast saying, I don't want to see The Undertaker wrestle anymore. It hurts.
Every time.
It hurts. Yeah, it hurts.
Shawn Michaels beef. That should have been the end. That should have been the last shit. That was the last
26. Time go. Actually, do you know what? No. To be fair, I did like the Triple H matches, the end of the era and all that stuff. I did like those matches. That was it. For me, end of the era, that should have been it. I don't care. The Brock Lesnar shit, no. The CM Punk thing, even though that was an alright match, no. I cannot forgive that match. No. Roman Reigns, no. Cena squash match, no.
That was sad.
Throwdown, Hell no.
Oh, God, that was right. No. That Reigns match, that was right as I was getting back into WWE. That was right as I'd given in to your pressure of telling me to give it a go, come back.
Are you sure? I'm pretty sure it was
that was the, that was one of the first...
Cena?
Huh? No,
I'm sure was... it was the Cena match, no?
No, no, no.
I'm pretty sure, bro. You sure?
No, it was. This was before the Cena one, isn't it?
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was. Yeah, you're right. You're right.
Cena one was him trying to get him back.
Yeah. Cena was trying to get him back. Right.
So I remember seeing it thinking, oh, this is the saddest shit I've ever seen. Like, when they try and reverse the Tombstone, it was like, oh, and they just fell over.
I remember seeing that live. I cringed.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, no.
I like that they didn't cover that up. I like that they didn't breeze over that and they showed it and you had him sitting there thinking, this is...
Natural reaction, like, oh.
Yeah. I like that.
I love Taker, man. But seeing him get emotional over stuff is...
I know. That's what I'm saying. Do I want to see the real... What reality hitting me?
No, I need to. I need to. Because I don't want... I've seen every wrestler that's been my favorite come at a character at least once. Undertaker's the only wrestler that's been one of my favorites that has not come at a character.
Yeah.
Not one time.
I like that he never broke character. It annoys me now.
Yeah, cool. But I mean, on the documentary, Skip, I need to see that. Sorry. I need to see that. I mean, yeah, you see him do a couple comments on other people. No. I mean, on his own thing. On his own thing. All right. Actually, wait. There was one documentary that they did.
I saw him
years ago. There was a biker taker. He did a documentary about he first started and that. He was still with Sarah at this point. Yeah, I remember that. But when he's at home with his girl, with Michelle.
When I saw him first break, it was a VHS. That was still a thing. And it was
when he's sitting there with the candles and thing at the back.
It was like this documentary that basically highlighted iconic matches.
All right.
And it was the Hell in a Cell. It was all these different matches. Like, you had the Kurt Angle and Shane McMahon street fight. And in between showing the match, they would actually have the wrestlers talking. Like, in between it, like with music.
Oh, yeah.
Really cool. And then this one, it had like... The
King of the Ring 98? King of the Ring 98? Or Shawn Michaels? Was it the 98 one with Mankind or 97?
Mankind.
Okay, 98.
Had Undertaker on there talking about details of the match. Like, real shit. Like, how he had a broken bone in his foot and how he was talking to...
Yes!
How he's talking to Foley.
He had a broken rib as well. What the fuck?
Talking to Foley and all that during the match, yeah. So that, I think that was the first time I saw him kind of break. But he still kind of had the air of...
Yeah, I hear what you're saying, but I mean, like, this one is so surreal. You're talking to Mark Calloway, you're not even talking to the Undertaker, you know what I'm saying? You're getting that whole Undertaker, it's five episode thing, which I do like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I mean, it's cool because we actually get to hear him say, oh, this was shit, I don't feel like I deserve to be back in the match. The guy went back to Roman Reigns and said to him, listen, I know last year I fucked up, like, and Roman kept reassuring him, like, no, listen, like, stop, like, no, like, I love that, you know what I'm saying? I love that, and this is what I felt I wanted to see of the Undertaker before he retired, because I don't want to see this shit years later, like, come on, you know what I'm saying? Like, it wouldn't mean nothing. Besides, like I said, I've seen almost one of my favorites, probably apart from The Rock, when it comes to their own documentary, like, break character, like, fully... be their real life selves for like a whole hour instead of just like a segment talking about this match, that match. No, talk to me about when you had just hip surgery. Talk to me about, you know, when you started walking again. Talk to me about when you built your own restaurant.
Like,
you know?
Into the bone. I was like, oh, yeah.
Yeah. I was like, trust me. I was like, I saw that little... I don't know what it was. It looked like a muscle or something. I don't know what the fuck it was.
Yeah, the joint. The artificial joint, yeah.
Dude. Oh, no, not that part. I mean, like, when he was in the surgery, he saw some redness. Oh, it looked like some muscle.
Yeah, it's all the meat, innit? All the meat around there.
That looked mental. Like, that looked mental.
Love it.
But when he started telling the doctors, I love when him and Michelle were talking about, oh, the surgeries. Oh, wow. I've had this broken. I've had that broken. The guy sitting on the laptop.
That nurse had no idea. They must have told her that he was a wrestler, but I guess civilians, man, they don't realize it's real out here. Motherfuckers get hurt.
No, the guy. Remember the doctor, the surgeon was like, I can't believe I'm going to be operating on the Undertaker right now. Like, yeah. You remember he said that?
Big, yeah, because he's big.
Yeah.
The nurse had no idea that there's going to be injuries like that. Like, you have you ever had any surgeries before? Like, yeah, motherfucker.
Oh, my God. Honestly, nah, for me, that's good. And I'm excited to watch this. I mean, what's the next one? The next one's going to talk about Super Showdown, which is going to be interesting.
Going
to be very interesting. Yeah. Guys, check out our audio version if you haven't heard about it.
Is that going to be on iTunes? Yeah. But
that's
going to
be this Sunday.
It's tag first, isn't it?
What's that?
The tag team first one, isn't it?
No, I think the Rusev one, then they're going to be the tag one.
But by the preview, they were highlighting the tag match.
Yeah, but the Rusev one was there first.
They will touch on it, but I think the main...
No, they'll talk about both.
The main match that they'll talk about. Because that Rusev one wasn't really anything, that Rusev one. It was just the...
No, but that was like... Remember, he didn't have a match at WrestleMania after that. So,
yeah,
it was Rusev.
That was the tag match. The tag match was the one to talk about.
Oh, of course. But, I mean, I'm sure they're going to talk about the Rusev.
Shit match, good match, shit match, good match. shit, because it's going to be this one, the tag match.
The last one.
And then the episode after that is going to be the Goldberg one, which is going to be even funny. I can't wait for that. I wonder if Goldberg's going to do interviews. I wonder if he's going to have the pride to actually sit there and be like, yeah, I fucked up. Shouldn't have headbutted that long.
Goldberg. Yeah. Goldberg. Yeah. Please.
Nah.
He probably didn't even come on the show. He probably didn't come on it. Guaranteed. He probably didn't come on it. I see no highlights of Bill Goldberg when this whole documentary was being... I saw Goldberg in the documentary, but having a conversation like AJ Styles did or Roman Reigns. Hell no. He ain't even got Kurt Angle to talk on there. Come on, bro.
Yeah.
Shame it, man. Like, guys have been in the ring with him. Like, he couldn't even get Goldberg to talk for 5 minutes. Even if the match was a clusterfuck,
I reckon Vince can cry on cue.
You think he can? Yeah, I think he can.
I reckon he's that cycle because he always does it at the perfect moment that he can cut an interview off. Because it was the same.
No, how many takes?
It was the Andre the Giant documentary.
How many takes?
Huh?
How many takes?
No, I reckon he can do it. I reckon he can build up.
Well, take one.
Yeah, because it's just. Yeah, I reckon because even with Andre the Giant one, he was able to cut it off right at a point where they talk about emotions. You don't give a fuck about Andre.
Yeah, but that's the same with the Undertaker. Like, even with the Undertaker, like, oh, Undertaker said he kind of sees you like a father figure. Like, how'd you be on him? He's like, no, I don't want to talk about it.
What is
he just stands there for like 5 seconds.
Eyes were already glassy.
Tears were warming up.
Turn it on right at the perfect moment, man.
Pull it with his heartstrings. You're not evil Vince McMahon. You are Vincent Kennedy McMahon. Just be yourself, okay? Simple as that. But, yeah, I don't know. I mean, it is worth a watch, guys, if you haven't watched it. Definitely. Definitely watch that Undertaker one, man. And watch Dark Side as well, man, if you're even interested. Definitely.
They're great.
Yeah. I had to go back and watch number one.
Have you started the wrestlers yet?
Oh, shit. I haven't, I watched the MPP one. No, I watched the MPP one before. I know I've seen that before. Oh. I've seen that one before. I ain't watched the others as well.
Get out there, man. Watch it.
It's good. Yeah, well, I've definitely seen the MVP one.
Especially Evolve, it's interesting. You really get to see the behind the scenes working of that company. And you get to see those guys before. Like, even with seeing Aries Spears. Not Aries Spears. What's his name? What's his fucking name again?
Who? Sean Spears?
Yeah. No, not Sean Spears. The one who's in, he just get kicked out of Zelina. Zelina's been killing it lately. I like what she's been doing.
She always been killing it. Come on.
Yeah, but they haven't really. Oh, before, they weren't really giving her nothing. There was a period of time where she was just standing there, just doing nothing. Now they're.
Yeah, but they had no plans for Andrade, did they?
They got a proper stable now. I'm liking that.
Yeah, she needs a stable, anyways.
Yeah.
Make her more like we need those power valets.
Yeah.
Okay.
Gonna work.
Then power.
Vince's manager. He doesn't like managers and shit. I don't know why. Because it's wicked. Why would you not have someone who can talk for people that can't talk?
Did Miss Elizabeth and Randy Savage not make you as much money as Hulk Hogan back in the 80s?
Yeah.
Let's not kid ourselves. Come on.
And Elizabeth couldn't talk, but it still worked.
And he, don't and he only heard her speak at WCW, and it wasn't even that much.
Yeah.
Come on. Come on. It's a joke, isn't it? Honestly. And yet, when it came to like girls with big tits and that, it's all right. Deborah. Sable. Sable didn't even... Oh, well, that's another situation.
Yeah,
Sable. Yeah. Deborah was terrible. Yes, she was. Sable was the only one. Really. And her, she couldn't even talk. She just looked good.
And you didn't even need sometimes wrestlers you can already... Let me turn the light on.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, I just did the same thing, actually. Oh, it looks way shittier with me. But yeah.
But even when wrestlers can already talk, sometimes it's still good to have the manager there because it just adds more. Because what, Macho Man could talk, but he still had Sherry. And those two together were wicked, man. Loved watching them two argue and bicker. And you couldn't get away with that shit no more because he was basically abusive to her. Crazy.
Look at the Dangerous Alliance. I know it was before my time, but listen, that was one of my favorite factions. And I went back. I used to watch old classic wrestling. It used to come on Sky Sports 3 like back in the day. But like, I used to love the Dangerous Alliance. You had Medusa, who can talk. Yeah, you had Ravishing Rick Rude, Stunning Steve Austin. Yeah, come on. Stunning Steve Austin, Paul Heyman or Paul E. Dangerously, Blood Clark, R. Anderson, you know? Bobby E. Come on, man. Look how many stars I just said that can talk.
How do come you on. Feel about how the old veteran wrestlers are being used in AEW?
Well, oh, yeah, let's talk about R. Anderson and the Jake the Snakes.
We're going on for a bit, so let's keep it short.
Should we talk about... All right, cool.
Well, we can save it. We'll save it for next time. We're going on a bit. We're going to be too long.
All right.
Yeah, guys, dude. See, so much to fucking talk about. And we didn't even really get into a lot of the shit that went down when we weren't watching.
We didn't even talk about the card. Hello, the card.
Let's just talk about the results. So, yeah, Double or Nothing this weekend.
Let's talk about it, yeah.
Mike Tyson! That's another reason why Cody could win because he wants Tyson to give him a belt.
I think Lance Archer's going to win.
It's going to be the final opportunity. You know, just what people remember. Tyson standing next to him, handing him a belt. I don't know, man. I don't want it to
be. I think Lance Archer's going to win this. I really think he will. I feel Lance Archer's going to win this. There's no way you're building this guy up just for him to lose to Cody. I won't believe it. Man. If he does, I'd be very, very disappointed.
I want Archer to win, but...
You don't see it.
I think Cody's ego may push it to him.
To be fair, Cody has been... The last big pay-per-view, Cody did take the L. So, given that, make sense for Cody to be the champion, but this isn't WWE booking, okay? Yeah. But at the same time, I mean, it's not like Archer can't win it later or win it the next week.
Got the momentum. I hate to use the word momentum because that's become this WWE thing.
But let's be honest, Lance Archer hasn't beaten anyone with any credibility. He's just beaten meh, guys. I love Dustin Rhodes.
Needs to beat Cody. So, what about the ladder match? Whoever wins gets a shot at the title. Who do you think it's going to be?
This is not one again. And remind me.
Okay, so spring up.
See, Eddie's got the list. Bringing up some old Jericho stuff. He's got the list.
Somewhere. All right, we've got Darby Allin.
Right.
Versus Cody Rhodes. I mean, Colt Cabana.
What a botch, yeah.
Orange Cassidy, Rey Fénix, Frankie Kazarian, Luchasaurus, Kip Sabian, Scorpio Sky, and one person yet to be named. So I reckon that's going to be the surprise.
Is that Ryder? Is that Zack Ryder? I don't know.
I reckon it's either going to be Zack or Gulak. That's to be one of the two.
It can't be Gulak. No way.
I don't know whether... Well, they said that...
That would be smart. Huh?
Apparently, he doesn't have any wait time that he can't...
No, he doesn't. He can compete if he wants.
But there's a lot of truth that his contract might not be completely over yet. So I don't know what the state is yet at the time of this. But yeah, but who do you reckon then? Who do you reckon who's going to win that?
Go through them again. All I got is Darby Allin, SCU guys, Luchasaurus.
Yeah. Orange Cassidy, Ray Phoenix, Kip Sabian. Yeah.
Maybe Ray Phoenix. Maybe. The mystery guy. Orange Cassidy, I don't think so. Actually, Darby Allin's a dark horse in this one too.
Yeah,
I mean,
they've been building.
He's definitely a dark horse.
Besides this, Mr. Cody, they've been building up pretty good.
But that's why I even said the Darby Allin match with Cody like earlier in the show. I said, you kind of put him on, man. We'll say Darby Allin was out there already, but I didn't hear about. I've never heard of Darby Allin until you told me in the Cody match. I thought this guy's good. And Cody's making him look like $1 million. Come on. So I don't know. Is that a Ray Phoenix? Well, Darby Allin for me. I don't know about anyone else, though.
Thing is, haven't we already seen, correct me if I'm wrong, but haven't we already seen Moxley versus Darby?
We have.
Yeah.
But who the ones to say Moxley's going to not drop the belt?
Me. I ain't going to lose the belt.
Nah, he's not going to lose the belt. He needs to lose it to someone credible.
Yeah.
Which actually could be Lance Archer, but we'll get into that enough time.
Well, that depends if Lance Archer loses to Cody.
Which I don't think he will, but
yeah,
we'll see.
If he gets the TNT belt, he ain't going to go for that belt.
No, well, I mean, the world title.
No champ. The whole point of that is to give more belts, not have one person have everything. Yeah, I reckon it could
that
be.
That might happen one day.
I'd like Phoenix. I think that'd be interesting. Phoenix versus Moxley, that'd be an interesting match.
Whatever the fuck he says. I like that.
He could win, but I reckon that'd be a good match.
Who's the mystery guy going to be?
Ooh. What about Luchasaurus, though? Maybe they could decide to give the Rocket to him.
He's popular.
He hasn't had really...
Like Luchasaurus, but he's just... No.
I don't know. He hasn't really had a chance yet. He hasn't really had a proper singles match to show his shit off. Maybe.
Nah.
Yeah, we'll see.
I like Luchasaurus, but nah. Sorry. I like Scorpio Sky as well, but no.
Nah.
Kazarian's too old. I like Kazarian, but still no. And then again, I like everyone in this match personally, but I mean, the only credible people to me is either Darby Allin or Ray Phoenix.
Yeah, I'm going to go
Phoenix. Or who this mystery person is. But I'm stuck between those two. I can't pick. I'm really honest. What about you?
Big matches. We won't really get into all of them. I think the only other championship match is the Nyla Rose versus Hikaru Shida. I want Shida. Shida was supposed to be their one. She's the best wrestler they've got. She's got the package. She got the look. She's Japanese, but have you heard her talk? She learned to talk by watching Harry Potter movies. So because of that, she has a weird English accent. And it sounds good. It actually works. I'm thinking, why would they? It ain't like how it is with Asuka or Kairi Sane. Like, she can literally talk with a weird English accent. It's actually like, you got a package there. Why are they wasting it by just... But Nyla hasn't had it that long, so I don't think they want to hot shot the belt around. So they probably will keep it on her, so... Neither ain't good.
No, but to be honest, she's a powerhouse. She's like aggressive. But yeah, I hear you and I agree with you, but
she's too green. I think that's the main thing. Ain't like
Yeah.
She's just shit for shit.
How much experience does Nyla Rose even have? I don't think it's that much.
Hardly, yeah. She ain't really been going that long.
No, well, I mean, experience comes a long way, I guess, but she doesn't have that much. But I feel they're just building her up to her have a long title reign, and they're going to build up someone more credible or someone come in and take the belt off her. Don't know who, when.
That ain't good. That's my only opinion. That ain't good for your locker room to get someone in to give them the belt, because it undermines, you start building that resentment in the locker room where you feel like, oh, we're here working our ass off, and then this person just comes in.
Well, who else is gonna beat her?
Shida.
Personally, The only AEW women's champion for me is nowhere near the belt right now. That's Britt Baker.
Britt has improved. Her turning heel has been great. I hated her when she was a face. I thought she's a failure. She's flopped. It doesn't work. She ain't the babyface hero that they were trying to make her act to be. But once she turned heel, all of a sudden, everything just clicked into place. It was like the fucking Transformers logo where everything just clicks in. I was like, yo.
She turned into Optimus Prime.
All of a sudden, she has charisma. Matches are mostly good. And she just works.
She needs to be the heel. She's got the look. She's got the fast
heel.
She's giving Charlotte a run for her money when it comes to being a character, okay?
Yeah.
Now, and I would say that with a big chest and my Arsenal top one. She is giving Charlotte a run for her money in being a good heel, okay?
This is a problem again with AEW, with their women's division. There is talent there. Yeah. The problem is,
they're not pushing them right.
Britt Baker is nowhere near the belt, but they give her a lot of focus. She's cutting promos. She's getting like little videos and shit.
But baby, this is the built-up thing. This is what I've been talking about. Maybe this is it.
For any of the other women, like I said, Sheeta. All this, like I told you, Sheeta can speak English. She got the look. She's got the ability, but they do nothing. Where's
even the girl that looks like she's come out of space? She's good. I can't remember her name.
Atlanta.
She's quite good.
Yeah, they ain't done nothing with her. Like they don't really build anyone up. Story-wise, where's the promos? Where's the story? Like Riho, they did nothing with Riho. They could have done a little short documentary about Riho coming to America, adapting to Burn, and they did nothing.
Even Cedric's girl, she looks like she can do something as well, but they ain't really doing nothing with her.
Yeah, they just don't build up story. Just one story at a time. This is the problem, the mistake that WWE used to always make. One women's story at a time, rather than.
Well, they're all new to this, and this is the only thing that they. Yeah, they all really got. They only got WCW heads, ex-WWE heads too. I mean, that's all they really got, man. I mean.
So we'll do this again next week to the results of Double or Nothing, and just talk more shit, basically.
During quarantine.
Don't forget, Voltron Network on YouTube. You can hear watch the video of this of our beautiful, beautiful hands and faces. And also you can check out DC vs. Marvel podcast, which I'm also on. And Talking at the Movies podcast, which you're fucking also on. Oh, too many podcasts, man. It's fucking too many. Yeah.
Dude, you need to do a Jackie Chan. If you do a Jackie Chan one, invite me on. Because you know me, I am a Chan fanatic.
We're doing minisodes, like me and my boy. Not specifically about Jackie Chan, but we did one about the Rush Hour trilogy, and he talks about all the DVDs he's been buying. God damn, he makes too much money because he buys too many of these fucking Blu-rays, man.
I'm telling you, when it's Jackie Chan, do a Jackie Chan marathon season. I'll be your guy. The guy be your special guest, guys. I'll come on and tear it up. All right? Especially Mills on Wheels as well.
Right, where can they find more of you?
Right, guys, you can find me on YouTube, of course. I have two channels now, of course. We all know we had the wrestling one, but of course, Wrestle Ruckus is the baby that is back, okay? So you can find me on my socially outcasted one where I talk about life, any people that go through mental health struggles and my personal struggles with my life, subscribe to that. And of course, what I'm wearing right now, Arsenal FC, of course. You can follow Ryan Williams, AFC. No one cares about your Chelsea crap, boy. Anyways, if you support Arsenal, of course, follow your Ryan Williams, AFC as well. I'll be working with, of course, other YouTubers who are on YouTube associated with Arsenal fan channels as well. So stay tuned for that. That's coming up very soon. So yeah, that's all the plans.
So, premier the race.
Ryan.
See you guys next week. Hella.
Peace.